Hi, this lecture will be on electrical power and energy, but before I start with this new material, I just wanted to reiterate what we discussed earlier about the analogy that we use between current and water in a hydraulic system, where we think of current as flowing since it's a continuous movement of charge, and that voltage is like pressure, you know, it's the force that gets the charge to move. So I think it's really important not to think of voltage as flowing as we think of current doing. And I think it's so important that I made up this ruler. Hopefully you can see what's written on there, but on the ruler is voltage does not flow. And I keep this in my office where I'm at right now. And if students come to office hours and, you know, they ever say voltage flows or they imply voltage flows, I take this ruler and I whack them with it. No, I really don't do that. I don't want lawsuits, but I do take the ruler and I'll show them what's written on there and just meekly, you know, remind them to always keep this in mind, because I really think it helps with the conceptual understanding. And if you think of current and voltage both flowing in a circuit, well, it'll just cause all kinds of confusion, you know, conceptually. So anyway, but today's lecture is on electrical power and energy. Here's a definition of energy. As you know from your physics, energy is conserved. Neither can be created nor destroyed, just exists in various forms, of which electrical is one. Couple of different definitions of electrical power. This one here, electrical power, time rate in which charge is forced to move by voltage. So we all know now that moving charge is current. So from this definition, it shouldn't be any surprise that mathematically electrical power involves both voltage and current. And in fact, it's the multiplication of the two that give you the electrical power. So the voltage across an element multiplied times the current through the element is the power. So notice I use the word across for voltage, because again, it's like pressure. And I use the word through with current, because we think of current as flowing. The unit of power is the watt, and you can see by taking the unit volt, remember in the previous lecture, we talked about how a volt is equal to a joule per coulomb. So if you take joule per coulomb, which is a volt, and multiply it times coulomb per second, which is an amp, you can see that a watt is equal to energy per time, okay, joules per second. So there's a derivative relationship between power and energy. So if you have energy to get the power, it's just the derivative with respect to time. And likewise, to get energy from power, you have to do an integration. And we'll do an example using these relationships here coming up after this video. Another definition of power is that it's the time rate of either supplying or absorbing energy. And if you have a circuit diagram where you've got some circuit element where a voltage and a current is defined for that circuit element, well, you can determine whether you have power being absorbed or power being supplied by just looking at the direction of the current at the higher voltage end of that element. So remember from our voltage lecture that the polarity tells us which end of the voltage difference is the higher voltage end. So here, in both of these cases, the plus is at the top of the element, so that's the higher voltage end at the top. Now, we show the direction of current with an arrow, again, implying that it flows. So here, in this diagram, we have current flowing into the higher voltage end. Well, if you have current flowing into the higher voltage end, that's an example of power being absorbed. Okay, power being absorbed, that as the current flows through the element, we're dropping voltage. And remember, voltage is an indication of energy, so you would be expending energy in that case. Over to the right, this shows that current is leaving the higher voltage end, and that's power being supplied. Okay, so from a circuit diagram, to determine whether you have power absorbed or power supplied, you're just looking at the direction of the current at the higher voltage end. Now, there are several conservation principles in circuits, and we're going to get to each of them. The first one is that the amount of power that's absorbed in a circuit has to equal the amount of power being supplied. Okay, so power absorbed equals power supplied in a circuit. Okay, CKT is my abbreviation for circuit. Now, this brings up something called passive sign convention. Passive sign. Passive sign convention. A little hard to write with the pen here. Okay, but what passive sign convention is that since we can write, instead of putting power absorbed and power supplied on each side of the equal sign, you know, we could write it just power absorbed plus power supplied equals zero. Okay, so since we could write the conservation principle of power in a circuit being conserved like this, well, it means that I have to assign plus and minus to these quantities so that when they're summed together, they equal zero. So, you know, someone decided a long time ago that power supplied it was decided a long time ago that power supplied would be a minus number and power absorbed would be a plus number. Okay, I mean, it's arbitrary. It was just to get the math to work out. I mean, you know, I think if I was the person deciding, I wouldn't have decided opposite. I wouldn't have made supplied the positive number and absorbed the negative number. Okay, but they had to decide one to be negative and one to be plus so that mathematically, you know, this would all work out to zero. I tend to just like to keep it simple, so I just remember this: power absorbed equals power supplied in a circuit. Then you don't have to worry about assigning this minus or plus. Now the last thing here before we attempt some problems involving power and energy is just that there is something called power rating. Okay, all electrical components will have a power rating. And the power rating, that's the maximum amount of power that that element can withstand without being physically harmed. So, you know, it's important to understand that if you're calculating, you know, the power for a particular element, you know, whether it's power absorbed or power supplied, and, you know, we'll talk about how certain elements can only absorb power. You know, there are other elements that can do either of the two. But when you're calculating power absorbed, power supplied, you know, mathematically, like I mentioned on the previous slide, it's the voltage across the element multiplied times the current through the element. So you're actually doing a calculation to get that power. But power rating is not something you calculate. Power rating, you know, in practice, that's something you look up on a data sheet that, you know, the manufacturer of a particular component will supply that information. It will tell you, you know, that this element can take so many watts. So you want to make sure that your V times I, you know, that calculation for a particular element doesn't exceed the power rating, because if it does, then the component will likely be physically damaged. All right, well, next we'll try to do some problems involving power and energy.